everybody out there in Pastor With No Answers land. And yes, I know that you are not in that land, but I do want to say that it is an actual land. And I can't tell you the exact location, but I will say we're going to have a big conference there with really cool vendors and Pastor With No Answers land. And I may even wear super, super skinny jeans and tell everyone that my bride is hot. And I'll say, people don't realize that I'm more comfortable with unbelievers than I am with believers. That was maybe bad. We talk a lot of stuff on here. Explore a lot of territory. And this isn't a knock on anyone, but I know there has been and always will be some Christians with more conservative leanings who will question even the validity of my Christian faith. Did you hear his questions? Did you hear what he's pondering? Did you hear what he stopped believing in? Can you believe he thinks that? He's gone. He's one of those guys. But even though that may make you feel a little more comfortable, I'd like to say three words to you. You can't do that. You and I came from the same family. See, I'm just like everyone else, man. I was a Pentecostal, evangelical, fundamentalist, man. I listened to Carmen. You know who I'm talking about? We're really, really in the same family. I felt guilty for missing Sunday night church on Super Bowl Sunday, so I'd usually only see the second half. Damn you, Sunday night church. I felt guilty for making notes in my Bible because the book of Revelation says don't add anything to God's word. So I'd ask for forgiveness for scribbling in the Bible. Now, I'm sure some of these, they are. They're extreme examples of how I used to be, but you've heard on this show, there's some huge things that I have totally made a 180 in. I see so many things through such different lenses. Shoot, I'll say I just have completely new eyeballs together. But all these other things, these big things, you know what? I didn't ask to be on this journey. I didn't choose to be here. In fact, if you would have described 2020 Joey to 2010 Joey, 2010 Joey would say that 2020 Joey is going to hell and maybe unknowingly even working for Satan right now. But it's crazy because some of the most significant changes is that I feel more loved by God more than ever. I actually love the person of Jesus more than ever, and I'm free more than ever. So yeah, I believe I've been guided by God just as much as the next person. I believe I've been misguided in many ways too, just like the next person. And there's still so much to learn, but none of that matters as much because I believe really for the first time that I'm loved. So I will say happily and boldly to my dearest fundamentalist Christian family, you can't get rid of me. And I can't get rid of you, not as long as both of our aim is to humbly follow that dude named Jesus. It's actually my aim and my goal to love you, even though sometimes you piss me off. Speaking of being pissed off, I was at the very early stages of my major depressive disorder, major depressive episode. I always forget that phrase. You'll be hearing more about that. I keep telling you that, but I really do mean it. It's just, with four kids, it's hard for Priscilla and I to sit down and podcast because once the kids are in bed, we're just super tired. But as I was entering this painful season and becoming burdened with pain, I had someone from, I'm assuming, Bad Christian Land, a listener from there, track me down at my church workplace, which, to be honest, I think that's a little inappropriate to, I don't know. Inappropriate just because, hey, this is my workplace. If you want to reach out to me from like another state, then just do it on Facebook. But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe that's unloving. But anyway, he basically left a couple of messages, both of them saying, I would really like to just talk to Joey a little bit. I think that I share similar struggles with him, and I really think that it would be nice just for the two of us to talk and open up about our struggles with mental health. Well, first of all, that's not something that I really want to discuss with someone that I don't really know. I mean, I guess I've discussed it in public with numerous people, many of them that I don't know, but having like a one-on-one talk, especially as an introvert, I don't want to do that. I don't care if we have similar struggles. I don't want to do that. And secondly, I was really, really feeling bad, and I just didn't have it in me to reach out to this person. And so what I did was I asked my administrator at the time to call this guy, because I did want to make sure there wasn't like a suicidal guy reaching out for help. But I just wanted my admin to gently tell him that Joey wants to know if you need assistance in any way so we can point you in the right direction, but he is unavailable at this time to talk. And with some technological savvy from my big brother Jared, here is a recording that I received on my voicemail with a voice over. Check it out.
Yeah, this is I called you a couple of times, and I was very disappointed by the return phone call I got. Sorry you're too much of a f***ing rock star to return your own f***ing calls. And I'm sorry you wouldn't reach out to somebody who might be going through some of the similar stuff that you went through. Sorry there's not enough God in you for that. What a disappointment. You f***ing worthless Christian sack of shit. Go f*** a dick, you worthless f***ing. Somebody reaches out to you, and you have your secretary call them back. Forgive me, Mr. President, I won't bother you again. You f***ing egotistical piece of shit.
So, I want to be clear on what I'm laughing about, because first of all, and I don't mean this in a mean way at all. In fact, I'm going to tell you in a second here how I actually resonate with this guy, relate to what he's saying. But I'm laughing because I really and truly appreciate the combination of words and phrases that he addressed me as. I've listened to this message over and over and over for those combination of words, because it really, really makes me laugh. But how I relate to this guy, I remember back in 2003, I think, that I reached out to Seacoast, which was probably like a 5,000 member church at the time. And I was just a casual attender, wasn't on staff, wasn't a volunteer in any capacity. And I wrote Seco saying that I would like to speak to Pastor Greg, who was the lead pastor at the time. And I basically said, I need some advice. And if I could talk to him, set up an appointment to do that, I'd be really appreciative. Well, doggone it, if 3 days later or 2 days later, I didn't receive an email from his admin telling me that someone else will meet with me. And I promise you, I remember telling my wife, and it wasn't in a mean-spirited way, but it was in this humble yet Jesus-like evaluation of the situation. I said, Priscilla, if and when I become a pastor, I never want to lose sight of people that just reach out that I don't know. I never want to get too big for my britches to not talk to those people that need help. Not even thinking about the pure mathematics of someone that decides to do that, and when that becomes maybe 25 phone calls a day, you end up not being able to do your job nor have quality time with your family. And I know 25 calls a day is an exaggeration, but you get the point. It just can't happen. It cannot happen. It cannot happen. Now, I will say, I'll do a little brag, that I know for a fact that those sorts of interactions do happen at my church with those guys, those leaders of our church. They do meet with people that reach out randomly on email, but they don't do it with everybody. But I relate to this guy because when he said all this stuff, it was just loaded with cuss words, but it's the same sentiments that I shared with my wife about, how dare he? I mean, I know he doesn't know me, but I'm asking for Pastor Greg. Not asking for somebody else. I'm asking for Pastor Greg. Pastor Greg, please talk to me. And now I'll turn the tables a little bit. And if I were able to have a conversation with this guy, I think something that he could learn is that you don't know me. And that can be taken in many ways, many valid ways. But the way that I mean right now is, you don't know what I'm going through right now. You don't know what's going on in my head. You don't know that I actually am feeling so poorly. I just, even if I wanted to talk to a stranger about this stuff, I couldn't because I was so messed up in the head. Like, you didn't know the pain on the other side of the phone as you're leaving a voicemail like that. And I will say, just for the record, that this sort of thing, it really didn't hurt my feelings, but it actually did make me think a good bit about all the stuff that I shared. And part of that stuff I wanted to share because I like sharing some stuff that's in my head, but I'll admit, part of it, I just wanted you to hear those phrases and combinations of words that this guy came up with. I tip my hat at you, sir. And this episode today, we have a good bit of fun here. And if you enjoy these episodes, you get something out of them, and you can't even go to iTunes right now and just give me a rating or a comment, you freeloading S-O. I'm absolutely kidding, but I will say a very gentle request that if you do listen to this, I ain't asking you to join my Patreon. People are going to do that if they want to do that, not because I'm asking them to do it, but I am asking you. Just go to iTunes. Leave a little comment. That's just a good way of getting this podcast out. And yes, I believe in the guests and the conversation that we have on here, and I'd like for more people to hear it. And I like having more people listening to my podcast. I'll admit that. I don't need to get all wrapped up in that, but I'd be lying to you if I said it's not about the numbers. Of course, I want to see a podcast episode get more numbers. In fact, I will share with you one episode for those of you that are potentially newer listeners. I think we've got quite a few of those. I want to tell you an old episode that you may want to check out. I'm so embarrassed. It's episode 17, Does God Predestine Where People Spend Eternity? Lots of people have listened to this. This is in the early stages of this podcast, so the sound quality is probably not good. I've probably changed how I've thought just since this episode, but it's quite a conversation because it's between a guy that is a conditionalist. I think that's what you call him. He believes that people that choose God will live forever. People that don't will not exist forever. Whereas this, and he's also believes in predestination, so it's already determined. And then the other guy believes in free will. So check that conversation out, episode 17. This episode is with Jack Hoy, and yes, you read the description right. I do ask whether or not stuff like lice and fecal matter, and then, you know, the typical question, earthquakes and stuff, is that a part of God's original plan, or is that like a fallen world sort of thing? And I also ask, you know, there's this whole deal about, we all know God doesn't have a penis. He's not male or female. He's also referred to as Father in the Bible. I think the Holy Spirit, the word in the Bible for that, can be translated as female. All that to say, there's a lot of people that are just like, why not call God Mom? And so Jack and I talk about whether or not you can go mommy on God. So anyway, I'm talking about this conversation. Why don't I just let you listen to it? Guys, thanks for listening. Here is a segment of Ask Jack. Jack Hoy, back in this thing. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing all right. How are you doing, Joey?
Good, good. You looking forward to unpacking some stuff today?
Yes, you like always.
You like to unpack?
I do. I am, so like I'm a verbal processor, which drives my wife crazy. But I also take a long time to process. And so, so this is a format for me that is fun because I like talking things out, but it's also challenging because I like to be able to take my time. And so the fact that I'm on record is a challenge, but I think it's a good one for me because it kind of forces me to think on my feet.
Heck yeah. How's your walk going these days?
With the Lord?
You should have seen your face. you didn't even pick up on the unpacking thing, but I got you with the walk.
Oh, man.
Hey, who are the primary people in your life right now who pour into you, and what do they pour?
Boy, that's a big question.
I'm just messing, man.
Listen, this whole thing is predicated on me answering the questions you ask me. You can't start with a bunch of things you don't actually want answers to.
Oh my gosh.
Man,
But you know what,
Joey? I hear the heart behind what you're saying.
You hear my heart behind it?
I hear your
heart. Good. 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 Well, I'm glad you hear the heart.
Jeez.
I'm glad you hear it. I'm glad you hear it. I have been in situations where I'm at like a birthday party for kids and, you know, my kids are at somebody's birthday party and somebody knows that I'm a pastor, and it's almost like they, and because I don't act super pastoral, it's like they size me up a little bit. And I had this one guy one time, he literally was like, "Hey man, how are you doing?" And I'm like, "Fine." And I'm sitting there like drinking a Coke, eating some potato chips, kids are running around, and the next question he asks, "What's God been teaching you lately?" I'm like, did we just go there to the creator of the universe and what he's teaching me? And you know, I'm just chilling, right? Like, and I don't even know you that well, and you're kind of a bad person if you say, "I really don't want to talk about that right now," but
I'll give you mine. I'll give you my stock answer, because an adjacent question to that is, what's the Lord doing in your life right now?
Right.
I went to Liberty for college and I was an RA and dorm leadership and all that. And so like every week at the meeting, it's like, that's one of the questions you ask. What's the Lord doing in your life? And my thing was always like, I have no idea. Do you know? Because I can tell you what I think he was doing 5 years ago. But like, to me, what is the Lord doing in your life right now? Is a fundamentally stupid question, because that assumes that you know. Like, find me a person in the Bible who understood what God was doing in their life at that moment, like when they were in it. Right. None of them do. None of them do. It's like, what's the Lord doing? You're like, I have no idea. Like, I'll be able to tell you in 5 years, maybe, what he was doing today.
Right, right.
So my deal is always, so it's Lord teacher right now. I was like, boy, that's a good question. I don't know. I hope to know.
I want to be here. Here's what I would like to say, and I guess it depends on who the person is. But I would like to say, when someone says, "What's God teaching you?" I just want to say, "He's been teaching me that I'm a really messed up asshole," and just see what they say.
You should just say
that's what He's been teaching.
You should just say it's a secret.
It's a secret.
Or
yeah.
You wouldn't understand.
That's between me and God.
Yes, between me and God.
All right, so something I've been thinking about for a while, and those of you that are potentially new listeners, Jack Hoy comes on here, and I have questions planned that I'm going to ask him, and he does not know what I'm going to ask him. But I did want to ask you before we go into that, like, how is the sermon researching going? How's that going? I know that you... Mm-hmm. You wear a lot of hats at Seacoast, but that's something you still do, and you do outside of Seacoast for other pastors as well. You enjoy that part of your job?
I do. You know, I don't want to. They wouldn't care, but I, you know, and I think we talked this before. I don't want to go into kind of the names of who I do that for. Just not because they would care, but just because people get weird about that stuff, like helping pastors with research for their messages.
One's a really, really big deal, man.
A couple of them.
You
want
to talk pastors as big deals? A couple.
Yeah,
of them,
I would say one of them is, you know, really well known, kind of within the church more than outside, and the other is, I mean, he's a big deal outside as well. But I some of the most gratifying work.
Let's just go ahead and say it. You do Jordan Peterson's research. Go ahead.
Man. I would like to have a conversation with him. He's an interesting dude. But that is some of the most gratifying work I do. I really, really enjoy it. And for me, it's also, here's the deal. The guys I work for, and I work for, not including my day-to-day at Seacoast, I work for about four or five guys at any given time. And I mean, these guys, you know, they're all good at what they do, but some of them are among the best in the world at what they do. And so I'm working for them and I get paid for it, but it's also, I feel like I'm getting this free education, mentoring relationship in terms of seeing how they put things together, seeing how they use some of what, I mean, because one of the things I love, it was hard at first, because again, my job is to give them stuff that will help them, you know, succeed. And it was hard. It's always hard when a client doesn't use your stuff and he goes in a different direction. It's like, I must have done a bad job. But that's kind of slowly transformed into, oh my gosh, like that's an amazing perspective. And it's like, I would have never thought about that. And so it's really beneficial because it's working with guys who are among the best at what they do, and they're fundamentally different from me. And so it's like, if I'm just working with people who are like myself, I'm going to grow, but I'm going to grow more like I already am. And so these guys really challenge me and stretch me and kind of force me to think differently, to write differently, and to really think hard and really be intentional about the kinds of stuff I put together and the kinds of things I find.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, and the free education part too, it's like you like to learn, and so you're getting paid to do research that you're probably interested in already.
It's one of those things where, the Malcolm Gladwell thing, it's not just a him thing. He just kind of popularized like the 10,000 hours, right? Like, you know, you put 10,000 hours, about 10 years into something before you're kind of really an expert at it. And I, for me, just over the last 3-4 years, it's like, I can see the kind of the change in how much better I've gotten at it. And that's really exciting to look and kind of see yourself progress in those ways. I love doing it. And you know, I just, like, people get so weird about it. Pastors have research assistants for their messages. So these guys are incredibly busy. Some of them never had any education or training for how to do that. And they want, and like, the point is they want to do a good job. They want to do a good job, and they want to enlist the help of someone who can help them do a good job. Like one of my deals, like, you know, any, you know, pretty much anyone who is a, you know, who writes a really big piece of history, or, you know, like kind of like a really big nonfiction book with a big bibliography, took a lot of research. Like that man had research assistants, or that woman had research assistants. Like Robert Caro is kind of who I'm thinking of. Robert Caro, you know, wrote biographies of Lyndon Johnson. He's still writing them. Please finish the last one before you die. And he's been writing them for like 40, 45 years.
On LBJ?
Yeah. And
really?
Yeah, they are probably the best biographies of the last 100 years. And and his wife has been his research assistant the whole time. Yeah. So it's like this guy, who is an amazing writer, he's an amazing researcher, he has help. And for some reason, we deny that to pastors, who, aside from having to deliver messages every week on, you know, a text written in languages that they probably don't speak, wrestling with some of the most complicated issues on the planet, while they are counseling and marrying and burying and doing all of it, running staffs and all of these dozens of things, some of which, you know, emotionally are incredibly difficult. You're a pastor, Joe, you know, I mean, you know, I'm a creative director, but you know, I'm still a pastor and I still, you know, have those periods where, you know, I do counseling. I have people in my office. I've performed funerals. I've married. It's like, I do some of that stuff too. I don't do it to the extent that you guys do, who are, you know, kind of, that's the full-time deal, 'cause I'm the creative director as well, but I do that stuff, from time to time, and it is incredibly hard. And so like the idea that they shouldn't get any help doing this thing that is really difficult is just a little bit obnoxious to me. And I just, you know, for whatever reason, Christians have always loved to keep their pastors poor, and helpless, you know, for whatever reason.
Yeah, I will say this though, and I think we've talked about this before, and you had some valid pushback, but I do wish every now and then pastors would throw it out there that they have a research assistant.
Well,
because they say these really neat, interesting facts, and you're like, and it leads everybody to be like, wow, they really are super smart.
You know what? Actually, well, a couple things. One, I do have a line. Like, I do not do, like, I would not straight up write a person's message for them. I did have a client years ago. I don't have that client anymore. But years and years ago, I had a client ask me if I would write his message for him. I said no. And part of it was a time issue. Like, I just got home with my family and you want this by tomorrow morning. And so part of it was like, no, I can't do that. But I would have said no anyway. And I think one of the rules of thumb is, it's like the, am I doing something that they are capable of doing and just do not want to do? And to me, that's kind of a line. You know, in terms of the credit, I don't feel that that is important. I certainly don't feel it's important from a weekend perspective. Like, to me, it would be weird and out of place. And gosh, honestly, kind of inappropriate for a pastor to acknowledge research assistants on a weekend, because there's no place for that. In the same way, it's like pastors, they have quotes and they cite sources, but they don't throw footnotes up on the screen, because that would make no sense. And even if they put footnotes in their transcripts, like, no one's going to see those. And that's honestly one of the challenges about messages in general, is how do you cite your sources? And frankly, there's no good way of doing it. But that being said, I actually, you know, I was thinking, I actually don't mind saying one of the guys I work for, because he actually named me. He did what you're talking about at a recent conference. So, you know, Rich Wilkerson Jr. has the has VU Church and the VU conference that he does every year. And so there was actually a breakout session that he had with one of my clients, where they were talking about communication and creating messages. And his the guy that Rich Wilkerson was doing the breakout with actually said, I have help. I have a research assistant, and his name is Jack. He's a pastor at Seacoast Church. And that was Judah Smith. And so someone told me that happened, and I went and watched it. I was really surprised, because I mean, not because I was like, oh, I can't believe Judah did that. It was more like, oh, that's really surprising, just because that's not really something people talk about. But
I respect the heck
out
of that.
Yeah, Pastor Judah was like, well, he said, I cheat. And that clip's on YouTube. It's, you know, you look up Rich Wilkerson, Judah Smith, communicating. It's a VU breakout from the conference they had a few months ago. But yeah, I mean, Pastor Judah said my name, said where I work, and said that I help him out. And yeah, I mean, to me, that was like, I would like to see that more in the sense of the way I'd like to see it more. And I'm sorry, I'm kind of hijacking this whole thing here. with this one topic.
Ah, that's interesting.
But the sense in which I'd like to see it more is I'd like to see pastors feel that they can say that. Because yeah. Now I don't feel like any of my guys would have a problem with people knowing. But I have worked for pastors who kind of explicitly said, people can't know that you're doing this for me.
Right.
And yes. And like I think that's a shame. And I don't think it's because I want all the credit. It's the God, I think it's the fear of what would this do to my credibility if people found out I had help writing my message. Or not, honestly, not even writing messages. It's getting background research and kind of, bouncing ideas off each other and texting back and forth. That's something that Seacoast does a really good job with. You know, we have message planning and message run through every single week. And that is, you know, our messages at Seacoast are in a lot of ways, a collaborative process. And there are a lot of benefits to that. There's some drawbacks to that. But I think that for me, I don't care about so much of my career is built on doing things that no one ever knows I do. And I'm fine with that. That's not something that has ever bothered me. And so when, Pastor Judah kind of says my name and what I do for him, that's nice in the sense like, oh, wow, that feels nice to be acknowledged. But gosh, I wish pastors felt like they could do that.
Yeah. What would you think about this instead of, because I can understand where you're coming from, it being out of place to say, by the way, what I just said, Jack Hoy from Seacoast Church, but why not? And let's just even think at Seacoast. Why not at the bottom of the message notes have a little asterisk or something that says contributing researcher Jack Hoy, blah, 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 blah. Or even where their name is at the top as far as who's giving the message, have right under it research assistant Jack Hoy.
You could.
I mean, would that be super out of place? And I'm not making. I'm not. I know it seems like I'm making a huge deal.
It doesn't.
I don't mean to be. I just think that I think it'd be really healthy for people to just know that because it is a tiny bit off-putting because I know behind the scenes and I said it a second ago, when a pastor says something really smart and people are like, "Wow, that's a neat fact," and it's like, yeah. They were spoon-fed that. They don't know. Because it sounds like that's just something they know. Like, I know this. And it's actually something they learned in the last week.
Yeah, well, sure. But that's how everyone is with everything you learn.
Sure.
I mean, everything you ever learned, you learned 5 seconds before you knew before it was in your brain. I guess here's my thing is, you could put... Or was it so to me, there are different levels. So to me, ghostwriting is like a deal breaker. Like if you have a ghostwriter, that person's name is on the front of the book, author with name.
Right.
I think that's fine. Now, in terms of recognition, in terms of whether pastors should have ghostwriters, to me, that is real sketchy. But in terms of what we're talking about, like with research assistants, to me, I don't think it's necessary or even appropriate to credit them with every message. And here's why. One, because that's what they're being paid to do. And two, because Seacoast is a good example. There are plenty of weeks where I'll give my clients, I'll send them a brief, I'll send them stuff, and they will use 2-5%. That's not unusual. And part of the reason is because things change and, in terms of what's useful, it's, doing research for a client is a moving target. So there are weeks where here at Seacoast, if you're in a message run through or message planning, you can have that same level of impact in a message. Should your name be on it? And so I think that's kind of this deal is, so at what point do people deserve credit for things like that? And I don't know. I guess what I would say is like putting their name on the note sheet, to me, that doesn't make sense. Putting their name on your transcript, it's like, sure, but no one's ever going to see that. And so to me, you might as well just go whisper it in a room, right?
Yeah.
I think And to me, it's not just about careful researchers. To me, like, what I really would like is I would like to see something addressing this issue of, again, citing your sources and showing your work. Because, you know, and because I totally agree, there are a lot of times where pastors will be up on stage and they'll say something authoritatively. And what people should be asking themselves is, wow, I'm going to believe that's true, but I'd sure like to know where you got that.
Right.
And I think that is the problem, is like the showing your work, because that's something that I do a lot, is I'll have clients say to me, hey, I once heard a pastor say this about this verse. Is that true? And I got to go track that down and figure out. A lot of times it's the, how in the world did that pastor get there? I have no idea. And sometimes it's, oh, I see how they got there. And yeah, that's basically right. And sometimes it's I see how they got there. That could be right. I wouldn't say it from the stage. Right. And so that's the sort of thing where it's like, I really think that pastors need to do a better job of, one, only saying things from the stage that they are like they would say before God himself. You know what I'm saying? Like, if because there are sometimes there are quotes that pastors like to use, and if one of the ones I hear pastors use a lot is, you know, and it's attributed to everyone from like Einstein to Augustine, and it's the bitterness is like drinking poison and hoping the other person dies, Saint Augustine. Yeah. And I'm like, okay, first of all, there's no way he said it like that.
Right.
Second of all, like, you got to show me that source. And so one of the funny things is, like, quotes like that, like pastor quotes, when you go look them up, if you put a pastor quote into Google and the first 30 returns are all from like other pastor transcripts, it's like, well, that's a fake quote. I was like, if it has been a past from pastor to pastor, that is a red flag. And so that's the sort of thing. It's like the, I have worked with the clients, and not anymore. I don't have this client anymore. I've worked with a client who said, hey, I heard this illustration once, and I did some research and said, I basically said, you have to understand, that is so wrong, I can't even find it on the internet. Like, if you can't find anyone who agrees with you on the internet, that is a level of wrong that I'm not sure that we as a society are able to really wrestle with. And I told him, do not use this. It is wronger than wrong. And he used it. And to me, and like, I showed him how it was wrong. I said, look, you understand, this is why this is wrong. Like, and I laid it out for him historically with data why it was wrong. And he used it. And to me,
the dude just liked it
because it was cool.
He just liked
it. It was cool. Now, I will acknowledge it was a cool illustration. It was just utterly wrong and false, and not just like mistaken, like it was false. And I showed him how it was false, and he used it. And to me, this is where it's like, man, if I had known the backstory and I was attending his church, I'd never be able to trust him again. And I think now, I don't think that happens like even regularly at churches. But I do think that, because like message content, there's not a ton of accountability there, is there? I mean, who keeps pastors accountable for the things in their messages being accurate and factual? And there's not a lot of accountability there. We really trust the pastor to do their due diligence. And I think all of them want to do a good job and have messages that are full of truth. But a lot of mistakes, some small, some big, creep in. And to me, that's much more than crediting any help. That's the thing where it's like, I would really like to find a better way to show work, to cite sources, and to help people understand, hey, this is how I got there. Now, like 0.1% of the people who hear a message would care about that stuff. But I think it's important, because I think that's a level of accountability that pastors don't really have for messages.
Totally, totally. Yeah, that's cool. I wasn't planning on getting into that, but I enjoyed that. All right, you got a good 20 minutes left. Uh-huh. All right, sweet. So we wrestle not against flesh and blood. You and I have both heard a friend of ours, Chip Judd, mm-hmm. say people are doing the best they can with what they have. We know that people have really jacked up upbringings. We know that people have mental illness. All of that considered, I think you and I both know that people do evil things, but is there such thing as an evil person?
Sure.
So we wrestle not against flesh and blood. People are doing the best they can with their upbringing, potentially mental. Yeah. You know, we know Jeffrey Dahmer was mentally ill. We know Jeffrey Dahmer did evil. Was he an evil person, or does that distinction even matter?
Yeah. Well, so I'm not going to focus on him, not because of him, just because rather than an individual.
Yeah.
So,
I just used him as an example. Yeah.
So can a person be evil? Yes. Because, and I think that the, you know, now obviously, you know, with mental illness, there's a large question there of, so to what extent can a person be held responsible for their actions, and what role does mental illness play in that? And that is something that I am not in any way qualified to really get detailed about. You know, that is very much a Chip question, and I'd very much like to hear his thoughts on that. But obviously I think we understand that there are levels of, there are kind of different levels that we can hold someone accountable for their actions based on their mental capacity, based on their mental health. And we treat them accordingly, right? When people die, when someone kills someone, we take that person's mental capacity and mental health into account in terms of how we deal with that crime. So we kind of already acknowledge that plays a role. For me, the role of evil is sort of the conscious, willful choosing to cause suffering that you don't have to cause.
Yeah.
I mean, to me, that is evil. And actually, that's why I just finished Jordan Peterson's book, 12 Rules for Life. And somewhere in there, he kind of talks about evil in a similar way. And that, like, you know, we all kind of acknowledge, and by we all, I mean humanity throughout, you know, every time and place has acknowledged that life, even if life isn't suffering itself, life naturally contains suffering. Life, a feature of life is suffering. Right? Suffering is inseparable from existing on this planet. And so willfully choosing to increase suffering is a fundamentally evil thing to do. That's kind of some of the ways that Peterson talks about it. And I really agree with that. And so I think that for me, it's the, you know, what, and so let's bring it back to more of a you know, Christian way, like, what kingdom are you choosing to ally yourself with? Are you choosing to ally yourself with this kingdom of, you know, darkness and evil, whose goal is to increase suffering simply for its own sake? Or are you, you know, aligning yourself with the kingdom of God? And so for me, to choose to increase suffering, to choose to cause suffering simply to do it, is a profoundly evil thing. And to sort of, the more that becomes part of your identity, the more just an evil person you become. And so I think it's entirely possible for a person to become just, you know, if you don't say utterly evil, you know, maybe fundamentally evil in their choices, actions, and worldview.
Yeah. So it with this follow up, it'll sound like I'm disagreeing, but I'm really just trying to unpack this, Jack.
Yeah.
But so take the bully at school. You know, I've told my kids many times, you know, when there's someone going around bullying people at school, I say there's a really good chance that there's some need not being met at home,
right?
Potentially some really bad stuff going on at home. So just taking the like an example of one kid that grows up and is abused, maybe sees his father do some really jacked up stuff, maybe has witnessed, I mean, this is an extreme example, but maybe even they've witnessed people being tortured, for crying out loud. And then you take a kid who had a Disney World upbringing. I mean, just great parents, went on trips, spent quality time, had little meetings where parents taught them and everything. That first kid is going to have a way higher potential for, I guess, what we're calling evil. So, I mean, if environment or nurture can play that much of a factor. That, sure. That's the thing that I think trips me up a little bit is my upbringing is a lot different from Charles Manson's sure. upbringing.
But. Well, I mean, so I guess part of it is for me, I mean, what level, when do we decide that someone is culpable for the actions they take, regardless of why?
Right.
Because to me, so what I think what we wouldn't say is, like, let's take someone and let's just, you know, posit that they're not, you know, they're not a sociopath, they're not schizophrenic, you know, whatever. And they let's say they have a terrible, terrible upbringing, and it leads them to, you know, kind of do these terrible things as an adult, throughout their childhood and as an adult. When they're a child, there's a level of culpability we assign to that that is different than an adult. I think that's appropriate. But I think that, you know, the one of the things that we expect of people as they grow up is to decide what sort of person they will be, no matter what the factors are.
Sure.
And now I think a big part of that is that I think we don't do a good job of in this country is we assume that is an individualistic equation of this person on their own needs to fix themselves. And I think that's wrong. You know, the roles that communities and families and local organizations play are enormous. I mean, if you have no friends, no family, no ties to any, you know, churches or volunteer organizations or sports teams or any, you know, if you have no ties to any group, you're not in almost all likelihood going to get yourself straightened out.
Yeah.
But that's what we expect of people.
Yeah.
And I think that's wrong.
Yeah. Gotcha. All right. So this question, some of it will maybe sound silly, but so first of all, I don't want to spend too much time on this, but do you believe in like a literal fall of creation in the sense of God created everything good and then something happened and it was no longer good? Do you see it like a line in a timeline that was crossed?
I don't know. Okay. I don't know. That is okay. One of the things that I feel like I've been thinking about for like a decade. And I feel like in some ways I'm closer to knowing how I feel about that, but I don't know. Yeah, I don't okay. know.
Well, let's see how I can ask this then, avoiding that as a factor with being on the fence with that. So I would go, I would personally say that God created all things good. That seems to be the case in the Bible, and God's a good God, so he created everything good. And so without using the terminology fall then, I've got three different things that represent kind of different aspects of inconveniences or tragedy or something like that. And so we'll go along the lines of, are these things God's original will? How about sure. that? All right. Earthquakes. Like, is that a part of God's original? And I know this is just kind of speculation and imagining and just having fun, but it earthquakes. I mean, was that a part of God's original plan to shake things yes. up and knock things down and people die and that sort of thing?
So I'm going to say yes.
All right. You want to say anything else or just leave it there?
Well, I've got one I want to ask, but let's see yours first, because maybe
okay. Be close. So two okay. more. Lice.
Yes.
Wow. And even what lice yes. do. Oh, all right. And this one, it sounds silly, but it really is something that I think about. Poop.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, so
yeah, I would disagree with all of those. I don't think poop is a part of the original plan. I don't think lice is, nor earthquakes.
Okay. So here's earthquakes is a little bit of a trickier one for me, but I'll give you another one. Vultures.
Vultures primarily eat dead stuff, that's right? Dead rotting. Yeah, dead rotting carcasses.
That's what they're built to do.
So I would go... I would say, what if... So I love that question. What if animals were originally intended not to eat other animals? So they weren't intended to be carnivores because that's... Yeah, it seems really brutal when you look at National Geographic stuff, you know, a lion chasing down a calf and that sort of thing. So maybe vultures, yes, but maybe not their eating habits. Maybe their eating habits were a part of the
So fall. Here's my thing. Then God built
because,
them.
Because maybe death was, maybe death for animals and humans and all of that stuff. Or I won't say maybe, I'll say I don't think that death was a part of the plan. So if there's no dead animals, there's nothing for the vultures to eat. So they should have been herbivores.
This is interesting. I feel like this is the sort of question that you and I usually on opposite side, like the other opposite sides of. So here's my deal. If vultures aren't eating dead things, God built them all wrong. Or he's hedging his bets. I have built this world where nothing dies, but just in case, here's all this stuff over here. Vultures make
but take evolution in consideration though. What if God oversaw evolution, right? And the form of vultures we see right now wasn't what vultures were a billion years
perhaps.
Ago?
Perhaps. So here's my view in terms of and this is why I don't know. Like my answer is I don't know about a fall, because I have leaving humans out of it. Humans are where I have like theological, moral, ethical questions about evolution. I've got no problem with evolution. I think that's what happened, right? Like, I think the universe is billions and billions of years old, that plants, animals, everything evolved over
Jack,
long periods of death.
How dare you, man? How dare you?
That's why for me, like, so what is Genesis portraying with the fall and with humanity? And I've got some thoughts about that, but nothing I feel so confident that like I would say it from the stage, right? But that's why for me, lice, fecal matter, Joseph, can we say that instead of poop?
Sure.
That's why
sure.
Lice,
we'll sound
poop,
more intelligent.
Vultures, earthquakes, like to me, I don't have problems with any of those.
I don't have a problem with them.
Sure. Well, I guess what I said is I don't have a problem with them being part of the original design in terms of the way things were set up in the beginning, because I tend to think that everything developed over a very, very, very long period of time.
Yeah, but lice sucks, man. How could God say, I'm going to create a bug that gets in people's hair and it'll be really hard to get them out, and they're dirty, they bite. And...
Well, but you kind of answered your own question earlier in terms of, well, maybe that's not what they did, but just evolution over long periods of time.
Okay. Right. Yeah, I can get with that. I can get with that. And for our listeners' sake, my thing with poop is that's waste.
Right.
And so it's neat for me to think of an original creation as not having
your
waste.
Your digestive system is a nuclear reactor. Zero emissions.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah, I guess you're right.
There's right. A thing that like it has a name, but I can't remember what it is. There's kind of a fallacy that a lot of maybe not a lot, but that we sometimes have in Christianity, where we look at the picture in Revelation, right? The wolf laying down with the lamb. This idea that there's no more sickness, no more death, right? No more need, no more suffering. And we say, well, if it's that way in the end, it must have been that way in the beginning. And that's just not actually, doesn't have to be true. Like, there's nothing in the Bible that forces us to have that conclusion. There are parts of the Genesis narrative that are clearly, idyllic. But the biggest one is food. Like, the plentiful nature of food is the big one. And so it's like this, you have a picture of how it was in the beginning, and you have a picture of how it was in the end, but those things don't have to be the same. And for me, And the thing about death, the only thing that we know about death is that it seems that maybe that wasn't what God intended for Adam and Eve. But there's nothing about anything else in creation. In fact, the fact that God says that he's appointed the sun and the moon for seasons, to mark seasons. Well, you can't have seasons without death. You can't. There's no such thing as seasonal change unless plant life dies. There's no such thing as dirt without billions of years of death. And so to me, it's sort of like the, we see how things are going to be in the end, but that doesn't mean that's how they were in the beginning.
Gotcha. Wow. So God created imperfection?
Sure. Well, so what is it? What is perfection? Okay. So remember that movie Last Samurai? Tom Cruise?
Yeah. I don't remember okay. much
so,
about
so
it.
So there's a line at the end.
It's my brother's favorite Tom Cruise movie.
Well,
actually.
It's a great movie. And based on, you know, some unreality, the Shinsengumi, the last kind of samurai. Anyway, it doesn't matter. And there's this line at the very end, you know, like we're like one of the little conversations that Tom Cruise and Ken Watanabe have is like, he's Ken Watanabe is always looking for like the perfect flower or whatever it is. And kind of this, there's, you know, the scene at the end where Ken Watanabe is dying. Spoiler alert for a 20-year-old movie. And he just kind of sees this, you know, this breeze carry all these flowers. And he says, kind of this moment of realization, he says, they're all perfect. And so to me, it's like when we talk about perfection, whether it's the Bible, whether it's creation, we're basically trying to give this engineering definition, right? Where perfection means zero flaws. Well, why is that definition of perfection extend to everything? What does it mean for an apple to be perfect? What does it mean for a flower to be perfect? What does it mean for a joke to be perfect? A joke can be perfect, and then 5 days later, you don't laugh at it anymore because you've heard it so many times. Is it still perfect? And so it's like we have this doubt. And like, so to me, so one of the things that in the New Testament, you know, Jesus says, be perfect as your Father is perfect in the Sermon on the Mount. And that does not mean totally flawless. What it means is fully formed. And that fully formed, it's a word that was basically used to describe like what happens when a child becomes an adult, or when a caterpillar becomes a butterfly, or when a seed becomes a flower. It's something that becomes what it was intended to be. And I think that is a far better definition of perfection, when something is what it was created to be. And so a flower that is missing half its petals, that's growing all weird and crooked, can be every bit as perfect as a flower that you buy in a shop, you know, for your wife. But we use perfection in a way that I think is really counterproductive, and just really actually is a bad word to talk about what we're trying to talk about. So, in terms of, well, can these things be perfect? Oh, sure, they can be perfect because they're do like. Can an earthquake be perfect even in the midst of suffering it causes? Yes. Because perfect isn't a good or bad thing. It is a, what is this thing? And is it what it was intended to be? So yeah, it's just a different way of using that word.
We just went into some smart territory. You lost me with some stuff, but no. That's on me, man. That is on me. No, that's super, super, super interesting stuff. Yeah, like the afterlife and how things were before, if there was a before and all that stuff.
Well, so like think about heaven, like people, it's like, so we perfect in heaven. What do you think you're going to look like in heaven? You're going to look like you do now. It's like, sorry, if you were hoping for a makeover, right? Like,
see, I think really weird about heaven. I think maybe we'll all have perfect bodies.
Sure. Well, you at least have an eternity.
Here's why. Like people that are grossly overweight, sure. not all of them have. I'm definitely don't want to put them all in the same category of having bad eating habits and not exercising. I know there's some physiological stuff, but for some people, like I, you know, the fact that I've got some extra fat in my belly is because I lost a little control over the Christmas holidays.
Yeah, right.
So, you know, that's on me. And that seems to be, you know, maybe you could even go so far as to say that was a sin of idol worship of food or something like that. But it just seems like we'll eat perfectly in heaven, or all the food would just be perfect in heaven.
Yeah. You've also got an eternity to get your perfect body. So, which is about as much time as I need. It's like, are you going to, like, I just think the, and have it all be perfect. So like for me, like, so what would you change about yourself? And I was thinking about this sometimes, like probably the only thing that I would actually change. Cause I really do think like the, I really do think there's something to like, don't spend a ton of money trying to change your body, like change things about your body that don't matter. Right. Like where you just go straight into vanity. But if I could, I would really like for my beard not to be so patchy. I mean, I basically look like an eighth grader, and that's always been real depressing to me because I like beards and I can't grow one. And so in heaven, am I going to have a full beard? Like, honestly, like that's, it's one of those things where it's like you want it. And then when you get it, you kind of feel bad and silly.
Hey, you look into my eyes right now, Jack. You will have a full beard in heaven. Wow. Bless you.
Wow.
You will have
all
it.
All right. Well, I will know that it is because you interceded on my behalf when I get there.
All right. Two more questions. And I think you're going to hate me for these also, just to be on the record. Any problem? Well, maybe not with this one. The second one you will. Is there any problem with people going, in quotations, going mommy on God? I have done a little research, and it seems as if the Greek word, or I think Greek word for Holy Spirit, is feminine. And I do think it's healthy that people are starting to recognize, wait a second, God doesn't have a penis.
Sure.
He's not, you know, just this masculine thing. So, I mean, would you have an issue of someone saying, Heavenly Mother, we just come to you right now, blah, 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 blah. Like, going mommy on God, what do you think?
I mean, I think it's as silly as people who insist that you can only refer to God as a man. I think that misses the point in precisely the same way as the other side. You know, so you have that instance in scripture where Jesus is looking at Jerusalem and he says, oh, Jerusalem, you know, I wish that I could, you know, like gather you to myself as a mother hen gathers her chicks. And it's like, Jesus isn't like having a gender identity crisis in that moment. He's, you know, using a figure of speech. And so like, I guess what I would not have a problem is prayers that say things like, you know, God, like a father, you are this to us. Like a mother, you are this to us. That, like, I don't have a problem with that. But I think that praying to God, you know, well, I guess here's my real answer. I don't care. And what I would really loathe is the people who feel like I need to care about it. Because here's my deal. If you feel real strongly that you need to pray to God as mother, like, knock yourself out. That's between you and him, and it, I don't see why I need to get involved there. But if you're trying to be like,
I love what you just said. If you want to call him mommy, knock yourself out. That's
him.
Between you
Well,
him.
You know, there you go. Falling back on just kind of the rote. But
I like how you're saying that, though. It's almost like if you find it super important to push back on that, that's just as crazy as digging your heels in the sand and saying, nope, just father.
Well, like, I guess my deal is I refer to him as father because that's how Jesus taught his disciples. And I say, oh, because it's a patriarchal culture. It's like, I don't think Jesus cared about any of that. I really don't. And I think that, like, so Jesus, the guy who let himself get murdered, he's like, oh, gosh, you know, I'm worried about what this patriarchal culture will say if I don't address God as father. It's like, do you really think that guy cared about that? No, he didn't. But he chose that word anyway. I think we should pay attention to that. I don't think that you can only address God as father. I don't. But Jesus chose that word. And if we can all agree that Jesus is a guy that we're trying to pay attention to, I think we should pay attention to that. And I think it matters the words that he chose. So for me, I would not address God as mother because I want to say I don't think it's appropriate. But to me, I don't see why I would. And that's not like not trying to devalue or condescend to you know, women or kind of this idea that God has feminine qualities. He absolutely does. He has to. You know, there's also this strength, I can't remember what it was, that Jesus, in a sense, Jesus embodied like this, the androgyny of Jesus, that he is both male and female because he pre-existed in bodily form before men and women were created. And that's a pretty new concept for me, but it's certainly interesting.
Yeah,
I'm not saying that Jesus was androgynous or a hermaphrodite or whatever. I'm not saying that at all. I'm gonna say it's interesting, like the idea that if we believe that Jesus pre-existed and he existed in eternity with the Father in bodily form, then he pre-existed men and women being created. That's an interesting concept. What does that mean? What does that, you know, what should we take from that? But for me, you know, when Jesus addresses God, he addresses him as Father, and I want to pay attention to the way Jesus talks about God because he is God.
Yeah.
So.
Fair enough. All right, this is the one I predict you won't like, but why don't you think Jesus chose even just one woman to be one of his apostles?
Hmm.
And let me ask this too. Was there, you know, I think sometimes we'll take something and run with it big time. Was there a chosen 12 for sure? Like, are the Gospels consistent with who those 12 are? Were there 12 main dudes that we can say, yep, here's the 12, here's the list, these are the ones that Jesus had a higher calling for?
So here's what I say. Like, there were 12. What their names were, that's a little bit uncertain based on, you know, kind of the different gospel lists. But like the idea that there were 12 apostles, that is, no one really disputes that either in the gospels or the early church.
Why not a woman then?
Well, I don't like this question.
I know.
One, because I don't feel like it's one of those things where I don't feel like I've thought enough about it. I guess here's what I would say is, before I answer it, is it is really important to note that Jesus always affirmed women being his disciples. Like when Mary is sitting at his feet receiving his teaching, that is the place of a disciple. And he affirms her choice to be there. In the early church, like Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene was the first person to whom the risen Christ appeared. She was the first person to carry the gospel. I mean, she was honored in the early church. Mary Magdalene's title in the early church was... they called Mary Magdalene the apostle to the apostles. That is a title the early church. Oh, those horrible, misogynistic, patriarchal men. That's a title they gave her.
All right. I didn't know that.
The early church is who we have to thank for the treatment of women and children improving to such extent during those first several hundred thousand years AD. I mean... And so there's that. And also in the New Testament, you know, that passage in 1 Timothy where Paul says, women must learn quietly with all submission. It's like, hold on. Paul's saying you have to let them learn. I mean, that's radical. He's telling the churches, women need to be allowed to be educated. You have to let them learn. I mean, that's a radical thing to say. That is, dare I say, very progressive. Nay, perhaps even woke. And then he says, like, oh, they must learn quietly in all submission. Well, yeah, that's how a student learns. Like, how else do students learn? They learn quietly and submitting to their teachers. So he's basically saying you have to let women learn, and women, you are going to be good students. That's a revolutionary thing to say. So the early church actually very much affirms women. It affirms them that they learn. It affirms their place as being fully fledged followers of Christ. Now, where the New Testament, and I think getting back to this question, where I think it clashes with how we view things today is what they are sort of not accorded is formal positions of leadership in the structure of the church. Now, I mean, you see, I believe, maybe I'm wrong, but I don't say if there were women deacons or not. I don't know enough to answer that question. But you still see, you know, women being very important in the early church, in Acts, in the New Testament. They occupy very important roles in the church, but this is where it's like it's sort of treated as though, but men are going to still occupy the formal positions of leadership. And to me, that is what's tied to this question of why Jesus chose the 12. And it's like, okay, well, there are a lot of ways to deal with that. Okay, well, that was for them, and now we've grown out of it. That's possible. I would say that's probably like Seacoast's position. Right, is that was then, that was very cultural, that was not binding for all time, and now we're a different, that's possible. I'm very sympathetic to that. Another one is to say that was binding for all time, you know, men are properly always referred to as the head of authority. You know, that is how God set it up from the beginning, and he is reaffirming that in the New Testament. That's also possible. I'm also sympathetic to that because I think it's logically consistent with it is a consistent reading of the Bible to me. But there's kind of, I hate like the, I'm not trying to straddle fence, but I think there's a better way to understand what might be happening. And I kind of first encountered it in the writings. I have no idea where, so I'm not going to try and cite the source, but the guy's name is Pascal Emmanuel Gobry. Look at me citing my sources. Pascal Emmanuel Gobry, he's a French Catholic. He's a writer. He's younger than me, which ticks me off. But you can find him on Twitter. Goes by Peg. Pascal Emmanuel Gobry, I love him. He's great. And he wrote something years ago that really changed the way I think about this. And he basically said, like, women, here's the deal. In all likelihood, you are going to find yourself in positions where you are a more effective leader than your husband, where you are a more effective leader than the pastor you work for. So, and you're called to serve them, not to try and occupy those positions. Basically, you're called to kind of humble service, even though you could do it better. And to me, that's really intriguing, because to me, that is a very Christian way of understanding, because it's not the, well, I can do this and therefore I should. It's because, like, here's the deal. Jesus could have been king. He could have been king of the world, and he would have done it perfectly. And he would have solved, if Jesus had never gone on the cross, he could have perhaps solved every problem the world ever had in a position of absolute authority. And he didn't. He chose a life of humble service. He didn't even try to like be the best rabbi. He didn't try to like take over the temple. He didn't try to become chief priest. He didn't try to do any of this stuff. He did what he was called to do. And so I think there's this deal is like, look, and this is kind of Gobry's point is that, so even if God is saying, I want men to occupy these positions, what he's not saying is because they're better at it. And I also think that is, in some sense, that is a potentially beautiful way of us interacting, because what it means is those who might have greater abilities are called to serve and encourage and help those who are called to something that might be a bit beyond them. And like to it. Me, that is, because it's not just a right and wrong. To me, it's like that is a little bit beautiful in the sense of I'm not just called to seek my own. I'm called to serve. And look, here's the deal. Kind of bringing it full circle. There are guys that I serve, you know, clients, sometimes, you know, people in my position, you know, here as creative director, they're sometimes like campuses and ministries and clients I work with. It's like the, you know, if I just went in there, I could do a better job, but that's not what I'm called to do. I'm called to serve them. It doesn't matter who could do it better. It doesn't matter if I could plug one of my team in there to go fix that problem. That's not what I'm called here to do. And so I think like the, why aren't women in leadership? I don't think that's really the important question. I think it's the, what are we called to do as a community? And so perhaps God has called men into these positions, not because they're men and not because they're better because they're men, right? But just because he has. And our goal right. is to support them, even though it is going to be beyond a lot of their capabilities. I think that's a really interesting and a much, to me, healthier way of looking at it.
Yeah, and what's interesting too is it makes perfect sense. So let's say God did that. He said, you know what? I'm going to put men in this higher position of authority. Of course, we're going to mess that right. up and abuse it and twist it and make things jacked yeah. up. Of course, we're yeah. going to do that. You know, so maybe God did do that, but if we would have always carried that out well throughout all history, then yeah. we wouldn't be even thinking
well,
about it.
And also, they're going to be judged a much harsher. Thing. Anyone in any kind of position sure. of leadership is going to be judged much more harshly. And I think that's part of the deal. Is like so in a sense, one way of looking at it is so men have been called. I'm not saying this is absolutely what I think, but perhaps men have been called to these positions that they did not ask for. But they're having to occupy because it's what they're called to, and they're going to be judged much more harshly for it. Like that, in a sense, that's kind of how I feel about the job I do now. Like creative director, I stepped in this role about a year ago, and there are a lot of parts of this job that are hard for me that require me to use a skill set I've never had to develop. And I get to do a lot less of the stuff that I really enjoy doing in terms of working creatively to make things. But it's because this is what I was, called not just spiritually, but like literally asked to step into. And given the position I hold, given the people and things I'm responsible for, I am judged more harshly accordingly. And there are things in this role that are a little bit beyond my ability. And if my team, which comprises a lot of, actually mostly women, you know, if they spent, you know, and the guys, if all of my team spent their time thinking, I could be doing this better, I'm going to fail at my job. Like what I really need is I need for them to support me as I try to support them in this role that is in some ways still beyond some of my capabilities that I'm still developing. Like I need that support to step into this role that I've been called into. And if their only thing is, well, why is he there? Then I'm going to fail and they're going to fail and everything's going to fall apart. I mean, it's all tied together. Yep. So.
Yep. All right. Well, Jack, you poured into us well today, man. Heavenly Mother who gave us Lice and Earthquakes is very proud.
Hey, look, just, you know, there are lots of gifts that you got to grow up to understand.